Hello, everybody, and welcome to Seeds of Liberty podcast episode 39. So we're going to go with Jeremy for the BIPCOT No Gov license.
Yes, the Seeds of Liberty podcast, as always, is covered by the BIPCOT No Government license. This allows for reuse by anyone except for governments and the agents thereof. You can find out more information about this at BIPCOT.org.
So today we have Rand Eastwood, a voluntarist, anarchist, liberty operative. He runs Operation Liberty and Randwood Eastwood blog, Facebook pages. You can find him on Twitter at Rand_Eastwood and his website RandEastwood.com. You can follow all of his work. He's a writer, and he's going to start a YouTube channel, hopefully a podcast, right? He just put up his first video, which is the interview that I did with him. So hopefully he's going to be another voice for liberty on YouTube and hopefully on iTunes and Stitcher as well. So,
so
Rand,
cool.
Rand, thanks a lot for coming on the show.
Oh, it's my pleasure. Thanks for having me.
I had a great conversation with you last time and, just had to get you on the Seeds of Liberty. You're a really awesome guy, putting out some cool content. You know, we got to support each other. There's very few of us out there, so, you know, we got to help each other out. So today you want to discuss gun control, banning guns, and cultural collectivism. So I assume gun control and the banning of the guns is in response to, you know, the San Bernardino stuff and all the Oregon, the college shootings. And it's on a lot of people's minds, right? So can you go into like what you mean by cultural collectivism?
Well, that's my response to Lou Rockwell and Stefan Mullen, who came out sort of against. I agree with Jeremy. We don't want to say open borders. We want to say no borders. So I've just been saying open immigration, just a blanket term. The free movement of people, whether it's immigrants or the influx of refugees. And I was kind of surprised that both of them came out against it, which it's an issue that I hadn't really thought a lot about. So it kind of sent me down that path of thinking about that whole thing. But the reason I came up with cultural collectivism is because I felt that Rockwell really keyed on the cultural issue when he was coming out against the immigration of peoples into the existing culture. Whereas Molyneux really was running the numbers, and he was talking more economically, but it was still collectivist in nature. And I thought that Rockwell culture is an abstraction, just like society or government or community. It's a collection of individuals, and culture, you know, blankets everything, that collection of individuals, you know, art and music and language and religion and economy and, you know, social norms, you know, all that goes into the culture. And I felt like, you know, my first instinct was when he was saying that an influx of people outside of that culture into that culture would damage or destroy, it would be bad for that culture. And to me, that's collectivist thinking. You know, you can't say it's going to be bad for the culture.
Well, like, all right, so what we have to do is start, like, if you heard my response to this or on the whole refugee thing, it was that I agree with the Stefan Molyneux and the Lou Rockwell. There are some more semantics to my argument than theirs, but it's a principle thing. If you're going to be a libertarian, if you're going to be a voluntarist, you have to be principled, okay? And the government moving or relocating anyone goes against, you know, it's one of those questions, should the government? No, the government shouldn't do anything, all right? So this refugee thing is just a byproduct of government action. So to be for it is to be for government action, in my opinion.
I think this is where we had the breakdown originally when we had that conversation with Jared Howe on this topic. And at the end, he ended up saying that he now understood where I was coming from because the way you just framed it again, is the problem we ran into that we discussed with Jared, and we were talking about communication with not just between ourselves, but with everybody else, and how there was this breakdown in communication because of the whole confusion between no borders and open borders and closed borders. Like, people are just throwing these terms around. Some people are using them interchangeably, right? Because, yeah, state action, I believe Rand, you're on the same page, because I said during that episode, I'm in agreement with that. I don't want the state using money to bring these people over. My whole argument, I think what Rand was saying is the same one, that it's the free movement of people across these.
No, I'm totally for refugees.
That's all I'm saying.
I'm against the government subsidizing a refugee movement.
Yeah, no, okay. Yeah, no, I know, but I...
But I wanted to address a second part of Rand's thing about the collectivism. In my opinion, collectivism isn't inherently evil. It's only evil once force is implied, once it's forced collectivism. Someone puts a gun to your head and says, you're part of this commune, or someone says, you're part of this club, here's your card, you have no option.
Right, I didn't mean to imply that it's evil.
No, I just want to make sure people understand that distinction needs to be carried, because
right,
there is evil collectivization, you know, communism, you know, militarism, whatever. There's all this bad stuff, but there are good collective, you know, businesses coming together to, you know, work together to provide better products and stuff. That's collectivization.
Yeah.
So
but my point is that when something is collectivist in nature, such as a collection of individuals that make up a society, or the collection of individuals that live within a culture, a collection of individuals in a church or in a company, whatever it is, you can't wholesale, you know, blanket statement and say an influx of whoever into that collection of people is going to be bad for the culture or bad for the society.
Well, yeah, that does seem to be a little...
You're applying the impact of one individual to everybody equally, and it's not going to be that way.
Well, you're also implying that your culture matters. When cultural protectionism has led to some pretty severe bad things for humanity. I mean, the Nazis are just one example.
Okay.
I mean, the Nazis wanted to protect the German way of life and grow it.
I think we're getting bogged down in the definitions here.
No. I'm just trying to. We always have to. We're all in agreement here. I'm just.
Right. So, for instance, say that my neighbor opens his home up to a refugee family. First off, let me back up a little bit. This conversation is going to have the same problem that any conversation we have about a stateless society with people who aren't on board with the idea. You have a dichotomy, a contextual dichotomy going on that you got to bounce back and forth between. It makes it really difficult to sell people on the idea, because we live in reality. We live in a tangible reality, current, you know, this is what everybody has to deal with. But when we talk about a stateless society or voluntarism, anarchy, whatever you want to call it, it's an ideology, it's a concept, it's principles, and it's non-tangible. So it makes it really difficult people want to stay rooted in the tangible, and you're trying to demonstrate an untangible. So it gets real confusing. So I just want to back up and say that's what we're going to run up against in this conversation, because what we're going to be talking about is idealistically what's the right thing and what should be done, as opposed to what can be done realistically and practically in the current reality.
Well, yeah, so it's like the moral case versus things. The pragmatic case.
Yeah, and so I don't want the discussion to start being a conflict between those two. I just want everybody to understand, okay, we're going to be talking about what is and what should be, and I think we're all in agreement with those two concepts. So anyway, so let's say, everything else aside, my neighbor opens his home up to a family of refugees. You know, what's not to say, who's not to say that doesn't end up being the best experience of that family's life? to bring these people in and help them out. And who's not to say that that refugee family doesn't end up being, you know, contributing to the community and you know, everything else that, that you would expect of somebody. So you can't just say it's that bringing refugees in is going to be a negative impact on our culture, because some people are going to like it, some people aren't going to like it. But there's even a deeper aspect. This is what I've really been thinking about, is when people talk about the culture, influx of people from a different culture into the existing culture, and it damages or ruins the culture, whatever they think is going to happen to the existing culture, I think that's the wrong way to look at it, because the culture has to include everybody. You can't take the people that influx in and separate them out and say now the culture is ruined because these people are here, when these people are now part of the culture. They contribute to the culture. And I break that down by saying, say you got a basket of apples, you throw some oranges in there, and somebody's going to say, oh, now the basket of apples is ruined. Well, no, it's not a basket of apples anymore. It's a basket of, it's a perfectly fine basket of apples and oranges. The culture of the basket changes. So I think people have a tendency to look at the people, the influx of a different culture, whether they assimilate or not, as being a separate entity within the culture, when I think it really needs to be looked at as, you know, once they're here, they're part of the culture. So to say that they're ruining the culture or they're good or bad for the culture, besides it being a collectivist term, you know, some people just aren't going to like what they see and some people are going to be fine with it. So you can't say it's going to be good or bad for the culture. And I don't think you can exclude them from the culture once they're part of the culture. Does that make sense? I see Jeremy over there smiling. Maybe I'm being
No, no, no. I was catching something at Danilo's camera. I understand what you're saying. I think maybe, which is funny because I was almost bashing the two of them during that last episode. But I think to play devil's advocate a little bit here, because you had said originally, you know, that Rockwell was taking this more definitive line on the whole culture issue. I don't know if you haven't listened to all of Molyneux's discussion on this, but he definitely makes the cultural case repeatedly. So they're both on the same page. And to play devil's advocate a little bit, at least the arguments I've heard from both of them are, in theory, they kind of make sense, because they're going off the basis of other, you know, what has happened to other countries throughout history when there's been this giant influx. And they're basically standing up against, at least from my understanding, against forced multiculturalism. That is their issue, which again comes in, which is, I think, where hazy there, because, you know, like with the whole thing with Dave, where Dave's, you know, very strong position against, you know, not this, but it comes off sometimes as, you know, if you're for it in any way, well, no, we're for it if the state's force is not involved. And I think that's what they, again, I may be wrong, but that's what I got out of both of their arguments in that regard, that it's the forced multiculturalism they have a problem with, and that can disrupt the culture. And they also, I know at least Molyneux did, because I listened to one of his things on it, that just to see his perspective on it, and it was he was mentioning other countries and how these great demographic shifts from these influx of refugees in other situations in historical times have caused issues, because we are a tribal species. And, you know,
yeah, no one wants to walk out of their house and see no one that looks like them. That's just an inherent thing that makes you a human.
Exactly. And a lot of people mistake that type of attitude for bigotry or racism. And it's like, well, no, it's a natural instinct in most people. So,
like, and anyone that doesn't believe that, like, if in the middle of the night you were transported to, like, Riyadi right now, like anyone listening to this, you would probably flip your shit the minute you walked out of the hotel room or whatever you're in, because you're going to be like, holy shit, what is this? No one around here is like me. So I understand that, and but I think the case is should a culture be left up to basically the free market of ideas, or should it be, is culture something worth protecting? And I don't know. I like, that's a real weird one.
I think we're we're mostly in agreement here though. Like Dave and Rand, I think it seems like on the surface I have different arguments, but deep down it's basically the same. Dave's against forced government immigration, and Rand is saying there's no problem with people coming in if they want to take them in, right? And so we're basically on the same page. Yeah. What I gather.
If you want to make, the question is like such a second or third order of effect. Like I was trying to push last time we talked about this on the show, would there be refugees if the United States military wasn't intervening in Syria right now?
Right,
I would say no.
Into something I wanted to say with Molyneux. Now, Molyneux has a lot of programs out on this subject, and I've only watched one. And the one that I watched, he was running the numbers, and he was talking about the economics. What does it cost to settle one of them here? What does it cost to settle them in the Middle East? And he was really looking at, if you really want to help these people, then we should spend our, again, we get into this collectivist thing. We should spend our tax dollars settling them over there.
Right.
Rather than over here, because it's like 14 times more expensive to settle them here than over there, and over there, the culture, the language is, over here they're going to be a permanent underclass, and they're going to be a strain on the welfare system. All this stuff, and
that was my pragmatic case.
Yeah, he stopped and said he's for. Best case scenario for it to all be voluntary, but since it's not, this is going to be the next best. That's what he kept saying. Mm-hmm. Except he never once voiced a consideration for what any of the individuals want. It's like, I don't think it matters what anybody thinks is best for them. Does this guy want to settle over there, or does he want to come over here or go to Europe? And this is where Dave's point comes in. And that is, he probably would rather stay at home, but we're bombing the shit out of it, and he's got to leave, right? So that's true. You can say, well, if not for this, then this, and if not for this, then that.
Right. Well, let's just play ultimate statist risk right now. Let's play risk, okay? Let's say that all of us are just completely patriots. We're all in on the fucking bandwagon. Go USA, rah, 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 right? All right?
No, I'm not.
No. For this case, all right?
I don't know.
Would it make any logical sense to bring people that you're currently bombing to your homeland?
Too painful.
Like, it would make no sense to bring people you're currently bombing to your homeland if you were an invading force. Now, that's, like, if we're just looking at this as the pragmatic case as risk, refugees should not be coming in from countries that your country is currently bombing.
So you support the Japanese internment camps?
Not quite,
because that's the same thinking.
I mean,
well,
we went to war with
quite.
Japan.
No. It's a
Japanese living here.
Of course, we're playing ultimate status risk here.
Yeah.
So yes, I support. In that case, I support any internment of any people indigenous from an area that you're at currently war at with. And if we're going to play ultimate status, why are we not planting American flags in Afghanistan, Iraq, and Syria? But we'll go down that on another episode. But still, it makes no sense to bring people in to another country from another country that you're currently either at war with or you're proxy war with. Okay, that's just a pragmatic case based in reality that can't be refuted.
Are we still hardcore status?
No, we're just going back to logic.
Okay,
I'm lost.
Because you're still
what Danilo?
Oh, Dave, you're saying bring them in, right? Like the government is subsidizing their immigration. What if they want to come in? What if they're fleeing? Would you say no? Get out of here.
Hold on.
There's a difference, right? If we're bringing them
currently, can you name a country that does not have a central bank that is owned by the same people that own the central bank in the United States that could better fit these refugees than the United States. I don't know, maybe Turkey, maybe Greece, maybe Egypt. I don't know.
Well, that doesn't really answer the question, though.
Well, anyway, yeah.
Switzerland's not going to let anybody in.
I think, Dave, that seems like to be, that actually seems to be more of the internment argument, that you're just not gonna let even people in that are, you know, that are fleeing. You're just saying anybody who's being bombed. I mean, I know you're
I'm trying to make a pragmatic case here.
Yeah, but you're trying, well, I don't see how that's really pragmatic.
Okay, like you put these people from Syria who speak a certain language and you put them in another country that speak the same language that is inherently better for them than them being put here where they don't speak the language.
Well, again, that's a matter.
And their entire life is going to be subsubsidized by us.
No, but nobody's putting them there. They want to come.
Oh, if they want to come here, yes. If there's private individuals that will allow them to come here, yeah, sure. I'm not for borders, guys.
We're not moving pawns on a chessboard here. You know, these are individuals wanting to come here, right?
I completely understand that.
Well, I think.
But I mean, there is kind of like an impending civil war here.
Oh, there is not.
You don't think so? I think so. I think so.
Well, I just want to.
It may not go down like the last civil war, but I think something's going to happen.
Okay. Well, to bring us back to the collectivist topic and the culture topic that Rand actually wanted to talk about, I just wanted to finish up what I was saying before, because hopefully it'll lead back to that. The whole argument that they were making that you took issue with about them focusing on culture and it being like a collective thing, you know, again, I think, like I said, I heard both of their arguments, and I think they were thinking in terms of forced stuff, but again, historically, and because we're a tribal species, they do kind of have a point. You know, Dave said it before about, you know, being transplanted somewhere else. Yeah, most people feel more comfortable with people they know. So again, in theory, I kind of understood that argument. My problem is, and where I think I'll end up being in agreement with you more on this, is that when it comes to talking about the USSA, it's not like any other country around the world that has a culture, because they're very homogeneous. You know, the culture itself is very homogeneous. You know, like, we don't have that here. It hasn't been that way pretty much ever since they started importing slaves, and, you know, some of the Indians got adopted into the culture. It's never been that way. So for them to make that argument about...
Well, there's different levels to culture.
Well, yes, but... There's never been one culture in the
U.S. I will agree.
That's my point. That's why I'm saying
there's a forced narrative that the United States government pushes, but there's not a culture here.
The U.S. is a melting pot of culture.
Yeah, that's what we were always taught. That's the point I was driving at, and that's why I think, like I said, when it comes to the U.S., I think I would end up being in more agreement with what you're talking about, because that's why I took exception with their arguments, because it didn't make sense to me. I'm like, okay, if you're talking about Norway or Switzerland or Japan or any of those places, like, that all makes sense. But you're talking about the U.S. that has always had multiculturalism on some level. Right. So it's very to use that as the, you know, to upset the apple cart because you're going to be this influx. It makes zero sense, because it has survived every other influx of different people throughout the 30, 40 whatever years it is at this point.
I want to play devil's advocate when Rand gets done.
And what Dave said about does it make sense to bring people in from a country that we're bombing? It made me think about slavery, because I was using slavery in my mind as a comparison to the debate that we're having today with immigrants. And that is, again, we got that dichotomy of the reality, the pragmatic, the practical solution, or the ideology, the principles that we're all trying to insert into the argument. If we looked at slavery the same way we're looking at this issue, then the people that are looking at it philosophically and practically and you know, looking at how it's going to impact the culture and the economy would say, well, we can't be relieved, you know, we can't end slavery because we had this influx of people into free society and it's going to destroy our culture. It's going to be, it's going to cause economic problems, all these things, all these consequences. Maybe we should just let, you know, release a few of them or phase it out over 10 or 20 years or who knows what. Today, you would look at that and say, you're nuts. We're going to end it and we're going to deal with the consequences, right? Nobody's going to say, well, you know, if we let the slaves go, it's going to cause all this, because our whole economy has been built around the slave industry, the slave institution, and it's going to be all these problems if we end it. And that's kind of how I feel like if we say, well, if we allow immigrants in or we allow refugees in or whatever, that it's going to cause all these economic and cultural problems. But so what? You know, I champion the individual, okay? I look at human rights and personal liberty and property rights and individual sovereignty. Those are the things that I focus on. And so when I'm looking at individuals, whether they're immigrants from Mexico or refugees, whatever they are, I look at them as individuals and I say, what can we do to not violate their human, because it's not American rights, it's not constitutional rights, it's constitutionally protected human rights, and they're the same for everybody. So my position is, what do we do that doesn't violate their rights and doesn't restrict their liberty to exercise their rights, which then sends us into the la-la land of stateless society, and all this becomes ideology, because the right thing to do to maintain all those principles would be freedom of travel, you know, freedom of travel, freedom of association, freedom to enter into contract.
Yeah, yeah, and no one is disagreeing there.
So if you're going, what people are literally saying is they don't want to see the economic hardship of immigrants coming in, people of other cultures coming in. They don't want to see the cultural changes that will take place if people are coming in. So in my mind, that doesn't make it okay to violate their rights. We're now being selfish and saying we don't like what we think the consequences are going to be of allowing these people to exercise their rights and not to restrict their liberty to do so. So you know, I take that position, which is impossible the way things are, you know, because there aren't any free societies in the world anymore and everything is run by the governments. So you have that reality. And to me, that's like saying two different things. It's like saying we've been violating people's rights and restricting people's liberty for so long now that we just have to keep doing it because, you know, we have to. And my position is, when do we arrest that process? When do we break that cycle? Of saying mm-hmm. we can't just continue to violate people's rights and restrict people's liberties and take people's property just because that's what we've been doing all this time. When do we reach a point where we say we're not going to continue doing this? We're going to stop and start going back the other way towards personal liberty. So I kind of take that position, but then I have one other point to make real quick, and then I'll let you guys run with it. And that is, we're literally saying that we have screwed things up so badly in this country. We've gone so far down the wrong road, violating rights. We don't adhere to any of the principles that this country was founded on as far as human rights and liberty and property rights. So it's gotten so bad that we literally cannot do the right thing. That's what we're saying. We can't do the right thing because it's gotten so bad. And so the kind of the position I take, the opinion that I have about that, is once a society says that, they say we've gone so far down the wrong road, we're so far away from the principles, we've screwed everything up so bad that we cannot do the right thing, I would say that society needs an upheaval. You know, it as ugly as it might be, whether it's a, you know, a collapse of the dollar and a dissolution of the union and state secession, or whether it's a bloody revolution or however it comes about. But if you're going to say that everything is so screwed up that we cannot do the right thing, then I'd say
it reminds me
What I'm saying is like it's like stacking a 10,000 Legos on top of each other. All right? Directly on top of each other, and now we're worried about that last one going on the top. Whereas I'm trying to get to the very bottom Lego. And the very bottom Lego is that government shouldn't exist and this problem wouldn't be a problem without government. So exactly. That's my only approach to this argument is first principles, is the moral stance.
Right.
And that's why I'm against the government moving people from one continent or from one nation to another. If someone wants to move voluntarily, or if a mutual help, global mutual aid wants to help move people and they're going to pay for all of it, that I'm perfectly okay with that. So I don't think anyone making an argument opposite of that isn't really secure in their libertarianism, in my opinion. They're moving away from the principles that make you a libertarian.
There was a quote that came to my mind when Rand was talking. I think it was by Terence McKenna. He says, society is like a stew. It needs to be stirred up every once in a while where the scum rises to the top.
Well, he also said my favorite one, favorite quote of his is, culture is an operating system. Make your own operating system. Quit trying to go to other culture.
Right. And the other thing I was thinking about is that, you know, if you call yourself an anarchist or voluntarist, and you know you promote these principles, like you said, personal liberty and individual sovereignty and self ownership and property rights, and then you keep saying, well, like you said, Rand, like we've gone so far down this path, you know, I gotta support I gotta keep these people out because the government's gonna rob me even more to pay for their welfare and their subsidized housing. So we gotta keep this. I am an anarchist, but you gotta keep these people out because. But and so to me it kind of it's like you said, like when do you actually stand firm with your principles? Because I guess you know in a sense we all make concessions to be pragmatic, right? Where like you right. know some people choose to pay taxes because you know they call themselves an anarchist and they choose to pay taxes because you know the consequences seem too dire, too threatening, too dangerous, right? And other people say, no, I'm an anarchist and I will never pay taxes, right? And I'll suffer the consequences. And that's a personal choice that everybody has to make, you right. know, to how far you're willing to go
for
your principles,
like
right?
Like Erwin Schiff.
Right.
Like Erwin how far Schiff willing... spent half his life in prison rather than pay his taxes.
Mm-hmm. Right.
But yeah.
So did Thoreau. Thoreau got thrown in jail for not paying the poll tax. And one of his family members bailed him out because being a tax evader at that time was like basically akin to being a thief or a mugger, which I mean it still is kind of today if you talk to the right people.
Well, I just want to say that I think again there's a breakdown here on what people actually are advocating for, because what you just said, Danilo, I don't think most of the people, because I think Dave would actually fall into that category of what you were describing, but they're not, you know, anybody who, I don't think you can necessarily equate somebody having the position that no, they have to be kept out if they are an anarchist or at least claiming to be, because that's where the confusion was with my argument originally. People thought I was arguing against that position, but I'm not, because
it's a very layered subject.
It is kind of complicated, but I don't think most of the people, at least you know the ones that I've encountered, the ones I've talked to, and the other arguments I've seen, I don't think most of them are doing it because of a feeling that, oh, we can't go back now, we have to keep moving forward, because that is still a principled argument. I don't want my money stolen from me. It's being stolen from me anyway. I can't advocate having any more of it stolen from me. That's not going against the principles to have that position. That's the whole argument of, you know, yeah, anything forced by the state, we should all be against. Mm-hmm. If you're principled, if you're consistent. So yeah. I think we all keep running into
Well, it's akin to this thing where, you know, you hear the libertarian say, "Yeah, if someone wants to open a store and say whites only or blacks only, I'm okay with that." That to the non-thinking makes you look like and sound like a racist. Whereas that is the most logically consistent principle, because if you believe that everyone owns himself and that no one should initiate force on another individual. That's the only thing you start with. And that's the way I started with this refugee thing. Does the movement of these refugees infringe upon someone's self-ownership? Well, yes, because tax money is going to be used. So therefore, I'm against it. Wow. So therefore, that am I against people moving to this geographical location from another? No, not at all. As long as they do it legitimately, without infringing upon someone else's self-ownership and not aggressing upon them, I'm fine with that. So I think that you have to boil things down to first principles. I know I say it a lot, but you have to start from the principles, or else everything else you argue for goes to complete trash and utter nonsense. So that's my position on the thing. It's such a boring position to have, because you already can have all of my answers for every question. Should the government do, or should, how should this be done? Well, we should find a way that doesn't involve making someone a slave. Like that's the key.
Mm-hmm. All right. Well, I agree with the first principle idea, and then again that's where you get into the dichotomy when you're dealing with other people and you're trying to maintain your principles about the individual and the rights and liberty in a society that doesn't implement those things anymore. So it becomes an ideology rather than,
well, the government's going to do what they're going to do anyways. We're just sitting here talking about what should be done, not what's going to happen or what is going to happen.
Right.
So, I mean, we're basically trying to help people become more logically consistent with this. When we're talking about this, our only goal is to help people become more logically consistent and understand exactly what they're talking about and the correct position for a moralist to have. And I believe voluntarism is set in objective morality. It is objective to say that no one should harm another individual, and it is objective to say that everyone owns himself.
Now, see, I think you just keyed on the difference between anarchists and voluntarists and, say, minarchists or limited government libertarians. A lot of the principles would overlap there, but I think for us, it's a moral issue. That's why we're absolutist about it. And with them, it's not. It's a philosophical, it's a pragmatic, it's a practicality. So it becomes very flexible if you're not taking a moral stance and you're looking at justification.
Mm-hmm.
Like, say, we're going to release the slaves back when we had slavery, you know, we're going to end slavery. Well, those people are going to look at the impact on the culture, the economy, the farming industry, and all that, and say, well, that doesn't make sense. You know, they're going to run the numbers. Whereas we would be saying, this is wrong, it's going to end, because it's a moral and it's an absolute to us.
So, well, yeah, it's like the throwing a virgin into the volcano thing. It's like, if we just stop, then all the crops might die. I don't care, someone's life will be saved. Like, you know, so that's every argument that any is ever proposed to me, I always say, look, I'm morally opposed to this, and this is why. And I break it down to self-ownership and the non-aggression principle. And it's very simple. Everything becomes so simple once you start doing that. It's like you don't have to think, who will build the roads? Oh, I don't know. Any way that doesn't involve enslaving another human. That's how we should build the roads. Yeah, I can't give you a direct action on how it's actually going to be done, but all I can say is it shouldn't involve human slavery, because we're sentient beings and we can assert that we own ourselves.
Right, right. Let me ask you guys. Have you guys all seen Rockwell's talk, the Mises Circle, when he came out with the position on the immigrants and refugees?
I didn't see the actual talk. I read the transcript a couple times.
Because I watched it three times, I think, to make sure I wasn't missing something. And I guess maybe the problem I have with it, you know, morally I can't agree with it. I can't say, well, you're right, it would be better for the economy and the culture and everything if we didn't let, you know, I just can't take that position because it's a moral issue for me. But who Lou Rockwell is what gives me a problem, because you have this huge community of libertarians and anarchists that look up to him. You know, he's got, I don't know if he's the top libertarian website, I think he is. So you've got this, you know, top echelon guy, and coming out, in my opinion, after I watched it three times, it seemed that he was coming out against human rights. I mean, he was coming out and saying the libertarian position is going to be that, no, we're not going to take these people, and that's the right thing to do. But you guys haven't seen the video, so, but that was my take, and I guess that's where I had the problem. You know, maybe he just didn't present it very well.
Well, I didn't watch the video, but I did read the, you know, that's that when we discussed it a couple of weeks ago, I had read the transcript a couple of times, so I at least kind of understood where his argument was from. And again, though, I don't know. I mean, it's tough for me to say that you could be, you know, I understand you're taking a moral position, but those arguments that both he and Molyneux and other people have made, they're not wrong. I don't think they're wrong, because it's legitimate. Economically, it will be a drain because of the situation we're in right now. Because government forced influx will result in government subsidizing most of these people to live here after they come. So it will absolutely be a further drain on the welfare state. They're not wrong in that. It's a fact. There's True. No way to get around that.
I mean, look, if you look at it this way.
Well, hold on. The other point is, the, like Dave said, the government forced move of these people is going to negatively affect people who are paying into the system currently. We can't deny that. Right. For me, where it gets a little hazy is the argument of we're putting money directly towards this, because no, that's not true. Whatever money you get extorted from you throughout the year gets used on everything else as soon as they get it, and the rest of the money is just made up out of thin air. So I hate the my money argument, because it's not your freaking money. It's not, you know, well,
even,
it's not.
Even if it's printed, it's still your money. They're stealing the value of everyone's money. Right. Yeah, when they print not, it, so it is but, still your money.
Allow me to be very. Allow me to be very.
I don't think you can actually make that argument, because they have those ridiculous laws. Because if you're going to follow the money, they're the ones who print it. They're the ones who set the laws for it. They're the ones who can destroy it at any time. So, your wealth is a different story, but the money itself, yeah, I don't know if you can really call it yours.
They have first dibs before the inflation actually hits, but in the end, it is your money, though. It is everyone's money.
No, it's your wealth. It's
what I mean, to me, this whole argument to me is akin to, like, 100 people have an orgy, and one guy walks in and goes, "Hey, can I join in?" And you go, "No, one more is too much." You're already in a clusterfuck here, all right? The nonsense has to stop at some point. You have to say, you know what, wait, no, this is bad because of this. This has to stop because of this. We can say we're already all getting fucked anyway, so what's another one?
Well, no, I'm not. That wasn't the argument I'm making.
That can't be the argument is what I'm saying.
When you're looking at Molyneux and Rockwell, you know, I think the idea I had with Jeremy addressing that is, okay, we can't do the right thing because everything's too screwed up. We don't have freedom anymore. We don't have rights anymore. We can't do the right thing, so let's do the best thing, is what it sounded like he was saying, that, you know, those drains on the economy, you know, those are all true, and so here's the best way to deal with those, which is true. Again, you get into the ideology, the practicality dichotomy going on there. But I wanted to ask you guys a question, because you're talking about forced influx of refugees, mm-hmm. government forced, and I hadn't considered that in my argument, because I was thinking more the opposite of government forced, you know, prohibiting them from coming here and I don't know that I've heard. What do you mean by government forced?
Well, maybe they're bombing. Maybe they're bombing specific locations that have a lot of natural resources. That if you remove humans that could prevent you from extracting that resource, it would be for the better for all the corporations and the governments involved.
Are you referring to forced immigration or?
I'm saying that maybe the government
because of the bombing, or the government is saying we're going to bring.
I think a little of both is probably what's happening.
So I've not heard the government saying that they're going to.
Well, look, Rand. Rand. Either way, look. If the government goes, hey, no refugees can come in. We will by force stop anyone from coming into this country. They can do that action, or they can bring them in and subsidize them and make sure, and everyone's got to pay for them. Who wins in both scenarios?
Well, the government probably.
Okay, then.
Yeah. Okay. When I said forced, I was talking about more of like Dave's argument and the people that, you know, that it is. Because the whole argument Rockwell made was based not, I mean, yeah, he harped on the culture thing, but he also, the title of his talk and the subsequent article that they made out of the transcript was, you know, open borders are, what was it, a threat to, or something, or to private property. Mm-hmm. But to me, I thought he was conflating what should be happening and what is happening. Because right now there is no private property in the United States. Right. There isn't. You don't have any damn property. I have a house that sits on a plot of land. Yeah. I have a piece of paper down at the county clerk's office that says it's mine. Exactly. It says it's mine, but I rent it from the freaking government.
Because if you don't pay your property tax, they take it away from you.
Well, yeah. Well, that's the state government. They'll take it away from me if I don't pay my. No. The county government will take away from me if I don't pay my government. Right. Even if I pay my property taxes, and the federal government decides they would be better off with a highway through my backyard, then they will take it through eminent domain. So you don't actually. Right. There is. So that's why I disagreed with the private property argument, because it doesn't exist right now.
Exactly. That's what I said.
There is no private property. We live right now. We live in the communist wet dream, because all we have is personal property. Because
literally,
property is not allowed. So I don't know why the ANCOMs are always crying about the state. They should be thrilled at this point. But anyway.
But here's my thing, and I wanted to talk to Rand about this. Is like in some areas in Germany. They'll have like a village full of like 120 people, and they'll bring in like 720 refugees and just say, hey, figure this shit out. All right. That would be the German government. All right. So imagine if we just had 24 extra people just thrown into this Skype call right now by force.
Okay. Well, this is a little bit, you know, I don't think that's relevant. Because now you're going to extreme.
I think Rand prefers the orgy.
You like the orgy? I mean, I can always talk orgy now.
There's the bumper for this week's show, Rand saying.
No. I'm just saying that when government moves people, it's a bad thing.
I think we all agree with that.
Yeah, but just to answer your original question, Rand, about the force. That's what I meant by force, because right now, when like Obama got up there and said he'd be personally willing, of course, to take a certain amount, just like Angela Merkel set up in Germany, which she said, oh, we'd be willing to take this money. Who the hell? Who did you poll the rest of the people who live there? No, but
she said 800,000.
I know. But
and Muslims in the Muslims in the European and the Middle East right now, or not in the Middle East, but in the European nations, Muslims are outbreeding like 50-1. People that live there natural or were born there versus people that are immigrants.
Oh, I get that.
So that's another added level of scare of people scared that their culture is going to get killed. So I understand it. I understand their argument. We should keep people out that don't look like us, or at least control it so we don't lose ourselves. I understand that.
It's not understandable. I mean, collectivism is human nature. you know, all the way back to the beginning, the family, the tribe, the you know, and now you've got, you know, nations, sports teams, you know, it's a social thing, it's a psychological thing, it's an evolutionary thing, safety in numbers, power in numbers. So it is human nature, and the thing that really is a problem is collectivism, and collectivist thinking is human nature. But the only way to create a peaceful and prosperous society is the exact opposite of that, and that is recognizing the rights and liberties of the individual. So you have to go completely against human nature in order to create a society that will function. So you're going to always have this argument.
The problem is when people begin to hallucinate that people don't, you know, have different, you know, there's a separate class of people that have rights everyone else does not. That's when you get from, you know, tribal collectivism to a state government, right? That's a ruling class, you know, when you begin to hallucinate, you know, belief in authority, basically.
Sure. Well, I don't think you necessarily have to go completely against human nature, because it's still, in order to function, there will still be society. There will still be communities. They may be much smaller communities, but you don't necessarily have to go completely against human nature, because to me that's almost as extreme position as the people who say that, like, anarchy can't work because human nature is fixed. To me, that's the opposite extreme of that. That's not true either. It's not fixed.
Well,
it's fluid.
I did qualify and said a peaceful and prosperous society would have to be based on human rights and individual liberty.
Opposite
of collectivism in your thinking. So you have to be able to separate the two and say, okay, on the individual level, this. Like Dave said, I'm not saying collectivism is always evil. It's just I don't like people using collectivist terms. We need to do that. They need to stay. You know, I think it needs to be boiled more down to the individual. But when you were talking about forced immigration, government forced immigration, I got the impression you were saying that the government's, well, like you said, in Germany, but I'd like to kind of keep it with the United States.
Well, no, that's what
you're telling me right now that the Democrat Party.
Dave's doing it again. I still have not got to get this answer out. Give me 1 second, Dave.
Go ahead. My bad.
When I said forced, and when Dave
said
about.
You mean forced to pay for it? Is that what you mean by forced?
Yes. I only used the Germany example, and then Dave took it a step further to explain what is actually going on. Just to be like, because Obama said the same thing, we'll be willing to take in so many. How are they getting here? If it comes down, if that came down from an act of Congress or whatever it was, that they said, yes, we're going to accept this many people, how are that many people from this little area getting here without the assistance of the government? They're not. They can't pay for it. The Syrian government's definitely not going to pay for it. So that would be hypothetically taxpayer money, even though they're just printing it. But
I understand.
So that when I say forced, that's a forced immigration. That's a forced, you know, a forced situation. That's why I have a problem with. As Dave said, if some of them can manage to get here, or I had found one organization and I forgot to look further into it, but there was a couple of groups that are, you know, private charities that are starting up to try to help, not even move here, just to move into Europe or wherever.
Right.
Like, hook up with those people, and if they're, you know, I found seemed kind of reputable. I sent them a little. Well, I didn't have much money, but I sent them a little money because I'm like, that's how we solve this problem in a free market, you know, assuming the rest of this would still occur in a free market, of course, which probably wouldn't. But just on that assumption, that's how it would work. You know, you find people that are voluntarily willing to pay for them, you know, because the whole argument that people always, you know, like when the conservatives and the progressives argue with each other about this, and it's always like the conservatives are like, oh, are you going to put them up in your house? Well,
yeah.
no, why would I have to put them up in my house? I'll give them some money, though. Like, if they can manage to make it over here, yeah. Sure, I'll try to help them out. You know?
But yeah,
you're just a cultural Darwinist, Jeremy. Not a cultural Darwinist, but a economical.
So I was just a little confused as far as that term you were using.
Oh, yeah,
now,
okay.
Now I understand what you meant. And I want to let all you guys know you have kind of an advantage. This is going to be hard for you to believe, but I didn't watch the Obama speech the other night.
I never watch any of his speeches.
He said this. I saw it in articles. The number. I think he said 10,000 at the time or whatever it was. I was just like I said. To me, it didn't matter the number because like Dave showed the range with Germany saying 800,000. Like it doesn't matter the number. If it's anything over like five people, most likely the state is paying for it in some capacity, right. Which effectively means the tax cattle are paying for it effectively.
Being forced to pay for
which means, yes, which means yeah. You are being forced to pay.
Yeah, for like it. Why should I be enslaved for the government to move people from one place to another because of a problem that the government created? But anyways, just as much as I'm against government-funded refugee system or anything like that, I'm against the government stopping refugees from coming here as well. Right. Does that make sense? So, Rand Paul and Donald Trump have made it very clear that they want to stop Muslims from coming to this country. And I'm sitting here saying, I don't want to stop anyone from coming to this country. I just don't want the government paying for it. If these people can get here and pave their own way, not get on any kind of subsidy or anything, come here. Do whatever you want. I'm against the government.
I totally agree. Totally agree. I was focusing on prohibiting them from coming here, and I hadn't really considered the government bringing them in, and thus you've got a forced payment situation. Again, you know, the government shouldn't be. We all agree on that. I wanted to go back to the culture issue, though, because there's one other point I want to make. It's actually kind of two-faceted point about culture itself. I don't know. Are you guys familiar with The Fourth Turning, the book by Strauss and Howe, I believe.
No.
They're historians, and they identified a generational cycle of revolution throughout all of history, and it's a very, very fascinating book because they predicted the Fourth Turning, which is the final phase before revolution, to start in 2005, which was like they predicted that like in 1997. And then we had the economic meltdown and everything in 07. But supposedly, we're like 10 years into the Fourth Turning. And what that is, it's a generational revolution. It's based on what's called a saeculum. And that's the average long life of a human, which runs between 85 and 90 years. And they break that down into four generations of 22 years each. So each, and they've got a name for each of those four generations. And what happens is, you know, each generation is human nature to want to, you're looking for security, you know, you want to retire in peace. And each generation puts these things in place to secure themselves, typically out of the paychecks and on the backs of the next generation. And then the next generation and the next generation. And then you get four generations removed. And the fourth generation is saying, what the hell is this? They don't have anything to do with these 60, 70, 80 year olds that are running everything and taking all their money. It's all irrelevant to them. And that's when they say, and they're paying for all of it and they have nothing. So then that's when you typically get revolution. And in The Fourth Turning, the book, they show where the Civil War, the Revolutionary War, everything all was within like 80, 85, 90 years cycle. So it's generational in nature, and we're 10 years into the fourth generation of this saeculum. And so I wanted to bring that up. It's very interesting. I would recommend anybody to read it. It's called The Fourth Turning. Strauss and Howe, I believe, are the two authors.
That's going to be something on my list now.
Yeah, I've read it twice, and it's just fascinating. But the other thing about culture that I wanted to bring up, people want to protect their culture. They want to preserve their culture, and this gets into, you know, immigrants or refugees or whatever it is. And I think it's kind of a moot point because the internet, I think culture is going to change anyway around the world with the internet. you know,
it connects us all. Yeah.
Yeah. I mean, look at what we're doing here. You know, we have our own little community that we've created clear across the country because of the internet, but the internet is changing economy. It's changing culture. It's changing society. It's changing government. It's changing everything. And if people want to preserve their culture, I don't think they're going to be able to anyway, because the internet's going to change it. Because here's what I see happening. On the internet, everything that people are biased about, everything that people are prejudiced about, their preferences like nationality or race or gender or, you know, sexual preference or, you know, you name it. When you do business with somebody online, all that becomes irrelevant. You don't know who they are. You don't know. You might be able from the shipping to tell where it's coming from. But generally, I mean, if you click buy and you buy something, you don't know if they're gay or they're Muslim or they're Christian or they're white or they're black or they're Mexican or they're Asian or they're in this country or, you know, it all becomes irrelevant. And the two things that are maintaining relevancy is mutual values, which is how we're creating online communities like Voluntaryist on Facebook, and a mutual exchange of value, which is how we buy and sell and trade. Everything else becomes irrelevant. I don't care, you know, what your culture is. You have a TV that I want for $100, I buy it from you online, and everything else becomes irrelevant. So I think if people want to say, well, it's going to be bad for the culture, you know, it's going to impact negatively the culture or the economy or society, whatever, I think it's moot, because I think all that's going to go away anyway.
I mean, yeah, can you imagine fully? I've predicted the end of, like, by like probably 2020, the mainstream end of brick and mortar stores. Because why the hell would you even have a brick and mortar store when there's fully automated Walmarts out there with drone delivery that you can order something and have it on your property, on your front, the front of your, on your steps in 10 minutes right after you ordered it? You don't have to pay that drone insurance. Right. You don't have to pay. Yeah. Right. So it's all that just goes away.
You know,
so
it depends, because, you know, as long as the state exists, the brick and mortar stores aren't going to be able to compete, because they got all the overhead, a lot of overhead that the internet companies don't have. But there's two things you're seeing a human evolution here, because it's not just the internet. It's the internet, and it's the worldwide cell phone networks, communication, and it's proficient world travel. And everything up until maybe the last decade or two has always been based on geography. Nation states are based on geography. Who you do business with, it's all based on geography, and now that's irrelevant. It's becoming irrelevant. So I lost my train of thought there.
No. In my comment about the brick and mortar thing is about how fast internet is changing our culture. You're right.
The world
in 10 years.
Where I was going with that is I wanted to dovetail that into the immigration issue that I think you're going to see all over the world, because people have the ability to communicate and to travel around the world. And so it's not just a matter of creating communities online like on Facebook, but people are going to be moving all over the world because they can. I mean, it's
I mean, I had to look up the Farsi Voluntaryism.
You know, it used to be that only rich people could take a steamliner across the ocean to visit Europe or whatever, you know, and anymore, pretty much anybody can get on a plane and go anywhere and be in communication with people there. So I think what you're seeing is a worldwide change of how society is going to organize, how people are going to do business, and everything that we know today is going to go away anyway. We're not going to preserve how we're doing business today, preserve the culture, and preserve, I just don't think it's going to happen. And we're just seeing the initial tremors of that, I think. It's just now getting to where everything's...
You're getting into some real psychedelic shit here, man. Well, you don't realize it, but you are. Essentially, I agree with you, and I agree with you in large scale that culture, at least, you know, nation state based culture and tradition and stuff like that, is going to go the way of the dodo due to the internet. It's just like,
right.
You know, I was born right. on this earth. I owe no allegiance to any state, only to my fellow man, and that's only in nonviolence. That's it. That's all I owe another human.
My point is, if long term anybody thinks that we're going to keep people from moving around the world, it's crazy. It's not going to happen because how are you going to stop billions of people from just traveling when they want to travel?
Yeah, but I don't think. Oh, yeah. I don't think most people actually think of it in those terms. They're thinking about it right now.
Right.
Because most people don't think far beyond what they expect their lifespan to be.
Their next orgy.
There you go.
Their next orgy. We've got too much orgy talk in this show. We're gonna get the wrong kind of viewers, okay, Ryan?
As long as they stick around and keep clicking the like button, I don't care who they are.
I'm kidding,
I don't think most people think in those terms. I think most people are thinking about it now because. Yeah, I agree with you and what you and Dave were saying about how, you know, it's leading towards that. Absolutely. Right. But if anything, I think we're still in like the pre-infancy stages at this point, because while it's true that travel, as you were saying, has become much less cost prohibitive, it's still nearly impossible for probably half the world to make use of that, because you know when the occupiers and everybody were always screaming about the 1%, well, the reality is if you make over $33,000 a year, you're in the 1% in the world. So yes, costs have been cut greatly with travel because now there's options. You have, you know, planes are cheaper than like long-term cruises and all this stuff. Yes, but the good portion of the world still can't even afford what's available now. Will it get better through the internet and through the ability? I'm in agreement with you guys. I think so. Unfortunately, I think the state is going to, in general, not just ours, but just the state in general is going to be continue to be a barrier against that happening anytime in the next couple of generations.
Really?
This is something we've talked about before, and I've battled back and forth about this. I came to a realization a long time ago that I put the thought of getting to see this out of my head and just accepted the fact that I was going to die and the state was still going to exist in almost the same capacity, but just hoping that I had helped change some minds along the way. Like I had resigned myself to that fact, and I actually found peace in it. And I was like, okay, now I can focus on doing my activism. I can focus on trying to spread the message, on trying to teach my kids, because I'm not worried about, even though, you know, even if it's a happy thought, like, oh yeah, the end's coming. Like, I didn't have that hanging over my head. I see, like, certain times I backtrack on that because I see certain surges and I'm like, oh, this is great. It's we're picking up speed here, and we are from talking to people like yourself who've been around for, you know, a lot longer than us in this game, and seeing it, you know, everybody else you talk to who's been around that, you know, for more than 10 years in this at least in the Liberty type scene is all like, yeah, the influx in the last 3 to 5 years is pretty intense. Like, it's definitely a surge that we haven't seen in a while. So like, that gives me hope.
Yeah, but Larkin did that poll on his Facebook.
Yeah.
When did the
influx of people into the Liberty movement?
Yes. Okay. Like, it's like the past 3 to 5 years. It's like Larkin said it a bunch of times, and a couple of other people that I know that I've met along the way that have been like, I've been an anarchist for 20 years. Where the hell have you guys been? That's what like that. They're like, it's been crazy the past 3 to 5 years. Like, people are sprouting up everywhere.
I've been in it since 1995.
Yeah, that's what I'm saying. You've
20 going on 21 years, and crickets. Mm-hmm. People just think I'm a nut, mm-hmm. and then all of a sudden, like the last 5 years, bluey, it all, and that's why I jumped in back in and said, maybe I can.
Internet has become like. Think about this. Think about the very beginning of the Industrial Revolution. Okay, all the farmers, all the people that relied on things being a certain way and all that changing. We're at the same exact situation here. This is our Industrial Revolution. The internet is that. And I think that there is an internet culture that is pushing and breaking past this nation state and traditions and all that, because you can only be shut out from an idea for so long.
You go back to the fourth turning and the younger generation that's at the tail end of it now, that's supposed to be the fourth generation removed. It's an internet generation. They're not going to tolerate this. But Jeremy, I wanted to address two things you said. You made a really good point, I think, about a lot of the world still can't access the world travel issue. And I hadn't really, you know, I'm looking at everything from our point of view, from America, thinking, anybody can jump on a plane. Mm-hmm. So I will concede that, yeah, you've got a really good point there, and that maybe we're not quite there yet. But you really think, I see you're what, 40 years old? And you don't think you'll see it in your lifetime, huh?
Not the full scale change.
Scientists are predicting that the person who will live to, the first person ever to live to 1,000 on record, is currently breathing air right now. So you could see it, Jeremy.
No, I'll be happy. Well, I'm thinking in terms of the lifespan I expect.
Don't be such an absolutist.
I should have couched it.
I'm not an absolutist, but
I should have couched it by. No, I just.
I'm just messing with you, pulling your joke. You pull on me.
Well, no, you actually do make absolute statements. I said I.
Well, there's some time.
If anything, it's personal incredulity on my point.
Word checks out.
But I don't. You know, I'll be. I should have couched it by saying I will be 100%, 1,000% thrilled to be wrong about this. Absolutely. Like I'm not. Like I just. It helped me get past this point, because I went through that angry anarchist stage for the first year where I just wanted to shake everybody and like, why aren't you getting this? What is wrong with you? It's right here. I've done the research. It's right here. See? So I
enjoy speculating about it, and I don't think I'll see it, because you know I'm a lot older than you guys. I probably only have 10 or 20 years left, and so
you know, the atoms that make up Rand will always exist.
Maybe 30 years if they legalize weed here, but no, I'm just kidding. but I like to speculate about it. Well, people ask me about it all the time, usually, because of what I write. And it all depends on how it goes down. You know, I would really not like to see a revolution. I would, you look at the USSR in the early 90s when they just quietly dissolved the union and all the countries seceded because they just went broke like we are. So you've got that, you know, and we already have states talking like Texas and stuff talking about it. Or, you know, does the federal government, does the dollar crash and the federal government goes defunct that way because they can't pay anybody? Or do we have a bloody revolution? I guess it depends on how it happens, but I certainly think that it would happen within your lifetime, Jeremy. I mean, you're looking at probably at least 40, 45 years.
Yeah, well, see, what you said right there about, you know, how it goes down, I see, it there's so much up for grabs, you know, so much to speculate there, because just when you said that, like, I could see it going a couple of different ways just from what you were saying, because I'm a firm believer that the dollar will crash. And that will be the unraveling. Like when that finally occurs, things are gonna ramp up in a hurry. And now, how far away are we from that? I don't know. Peter Schiff and Ron Paul have been screaming about it for, you know, 15, 20 years at this point.
Right.
You know, some of the people that are up and coming in the financial world in the past couple of years are saying, oh, it's still, they'll probably figure a way to hold it out for another 5, 10, maybe 15 years beyond that. So like,
really?
Because you don't know, because I mean, they have so many people duped that everything they do is legitimate, that they can just keep racking up this debt for a while. Like they can find ways around this. So, but I think that will be the catalyst. For me, it's how long it takes to reach that point, because the mindset as of the collective as a whole is going to have a whole lot to do with whether the dollar collapse ends up in the federal government folding up tent finally and people being forced to figure things out on their own, or people just still stuck in that mindset where it's like, well, these guys screwed it up, we're going to have a violent revolution, and now we're going to take power, and they're just going to run the same game again.
Yeah.
Well, so never I, has a.
It's going to be the mindset of. It's going to be the mindset of the majority of people, when that dollar collapses, that's going to dictate how it, you know, how it plays out. And that's at least my opinion on it. That's how I see things going.
I would agree.
I'd like to interject before Danilo talks, that never has a fiat currency, the scale and size of the United States dollar, collapsed while Bitcoin has been in existence, or the idea of Bitcoin, anything variant of it. So we already have a non-state solution waiting in the grass for this dollar to collapse. All right, so not going to be people clamoring for a state.
You also have the drawing rights. International currency, the United Nations. See, that's actually, personally, unless people get educated really quickly, there's a couple ways it could go, because China's getting ready to back their currency. They're hoarding gold, and I think Russia's doing the same thing. Yep. And when they quit investing in the U.S. in the bonds,
I've already said currency, the minute yep. I've already said this, Rand, that the minute that Bitcoin has a gold-backed currency to compare itself to, it's over for the dollar.
Well, you and I would agree with that, but how many people in American society have even know what Bitcoin is?
It doesn't matter.
But
they'll learn quick.
Let me make my point. Let's say
it's a confidence game. What it is.
Well, for one thing, there's already been a state that's banned it. What is it, Connecticut? Who's banned Bitcoin? I just read it this week. There's been a state.
New Hampshire did something, but it wasn't. It wasn't. It was. It, the headline was sensationalized.
Oh, was it?
Yes.
I thought I didn't look into it deeply, but I did see
a snippet
that there was a state that had banned the use of Bitcoin.
I think some of the free staters were trying to get it to where they could pay their taxes in Bitcoin, and I think New Hampshire banned the paying of taxes or something like that. Yeah.
Well, but let's look. Okay, let's say. You know, a lot of people are saying it's going to be within the next year. People on the far end of apocalyptic thinking think that if it collapses before the next presidential election and there's civil unrest and they declare martial law, that Obama will stay president as long as he wants to be president. I've heard people predict that. But anyway, let's say in the springtime, you guys watch the shipping, what do they call that? One of the indicators of world economic, the state of the world economy, is the shipping lanes. They track the shipping lanes. Have you been watching what's going on? Because when everybody's doing well and everybody's, all the nations are producing and trading and the economy is good, the shipping lanes are full of moving product back and forth between the countries. In the last couple of years, it's been declining, and this year it hit all-time lows since it's been recorded. And last I saw, they're saying it's basically stopped, and that explains the drop in gas prices, because the demand for oil has dropped around the world because nobody's producing anything. The demand for energy is going way down. So I think we're seeing, on the world stage, we're already seeing everything coming grinding to a halt, and a lot of these people are saying that the dollar collapse could be within the next year. So let's say in the springtime, boom, it happens. China backs their currency. Everybody dumps the U.S. dollar, and it's like they. You remember the story about in Germany when they hyperinflated the currency? They talk about a woman who took a wheelbarrow full of cash to the bakery to get a loaf of bread. And she left it outside, and she went in to get the bread. And when she came out, the wheelbarrow was gone, but the money was in a pile on the ground. And somebody stole the wheelbarrow; had more worth than all the money that was in it. But when the money becomes worthless, you know,
it's worthless
to the 99%. Well, the thing is, if everybody around the world starts dumping the dollar, you have trillions of more dollars are going to go into the economy, and we're going to see it through price inflation, you know, where a loaf of bread's going to be $10. Well, the dollar collapses and you got no more purchasing power with the dollar, and the 99.9% of the people that aren't using Bitcoin or Litecoin or any of these cryptocurrencies, they're going to panic. You know, we can't buy anything, right? So what's to stop United Nations and the drawing? That international currency is called special drawing rights,
yeah, special SDRs. Drawing rights, right.
Yeah. What's to stop them when the world goes into this panic from saying, hey, we'll institute a world currency, which, by the way, I believe is why the United States has been adding color to their currency the last few years, is to get the people conditioned for a foreign currency. But anyway,
I think it'll be a global digital.
Mm-hmm. So,
I think it'll be a global digital currency tied to like your thumbprint or something.
But the whole point is, what's to stop? You know, when you say, well, when the dollar collapses, that's it. But what's to stop, like the United Nations and the special drawing rights, to step in when everybody's panicked and saying, we'll just internationally, you know, have a fiat currency. We'll say this is the currency everybody's going to use, and everybody flocks to it, you know, and then everything is just going to be worse because now you're going to be under a one world government. So what's to stop that scenario from happening once the dollar collapses?
At the present moment, not much. That was my point about the timing of it, though, because it's going to be the mindset. Because yes, if it happens in the next year, most people will panic and most people will gladly accept whatever the next thing that comes along is, because if it comes with the promise of you'll no longer have to pay $10-$20 for a loaf of bread, most people jump on it immediately without even questioning it. And yes, Bitcoin will still get bypassed and all the altcoins and stuff like that, because
it may get bypassed.
You're right.
What would stop them from outlawing it?
Well, yeah, but exactly. That's the other problem. Again, if it happens in the next year, it puts an extreme amount of pressure on, you know, people like us, because, you know, we see it coming, we know it's coming, but most people don't want to listen to us, and they'll just, you know, if they're still, most of them are still in that mindset, they won't make the connection that government is what caused this, and we should stop letting governments of any type make these decisions. And yes, the cycle will continue, and if it turns to a world situation, then yes, it'll definitely, well, okay, almost definitely get worse.
and the other dynamic that we can't discount in speculating how it's all going to come down is another world war. I mean, not just a world war, but, you know, do people start pushing the buttons? Usually when you have a world, when the economy gets as bad around the world as it is now, I mean, the solution typically is war, on the state level of thinking, right? And then you have the geopolitical rearrangement of power, you know, and so, you know, Washington is hating China and Russia and Iran asserting their power on the world stage. And I think they're either idiotic enough or, you know, hubris, arrogant enough to think, well, we'll start, you know, we'll launch the nukes, we'll take care of them, like as if, you know, if thousands of nukes go off around the world, I think it's probably.
I mean, that's why all these countries got invaded in the Middle East, is because they moved away from trading oil in the petrodollar.
Yes, exactly.
And if China and Russia do that, then their food ball, like they get moved to. With North Korea and Iran as the axis of evil, and everybody, but I don't think people are stupid enough anymore.
And now you've got the BRICS, what is that? Brazil, China, South Africa, the BRICS nations.
China, India, Russia, Britain,
Brazil, India, China, and South Africa are all doing their own central bank now, and they're moving away from the dollar. You know, everybody's doing it, so it's going to happen. But it's a matter of, how does it happen? When does it happen? And then what comes after? And it's pretty frightening that we could go into a dark ages of some kind of world tyranny. United Nations steps into the currency, or even worse, you know, a World War III, like Einstein said. You know, I don't know what kind of weapons they'll fight World War III with, but World War IV will be fought with sticks and stones. If humanity or all life on the planet even survives thousands of nukes going off, So it's hard to say, but the way I view it, I found out there used to be a sport, and it was like back in old Rome or, you know, Greece, or, you know, back in the gladiator days, where they had two riders on stallions, and they would race as fast as they could side by side down a straightaway, and at the end of the straightaway there was a gate that only one horse could fit through, right? So they had to, you know, if it was going to be a close call, it was going to be a mess because only one horse could get through the gate at the end, and that was some sport that they had back then. And that's kind of how I view what's going on today in the internet revolution and the freedom and the liberty and everything that it's fostering. And then the state blanket, the state around the world, the state is pushing so fast to try to get into a one world government situation. And I feel like it's these two horses running this race, and there's only going to be one room for one of us at the end. And who's going to win? And I vacillate back and forth because there's times that I think we're making great inroads in, you know, the internet and educating people, and people are coming around and waking up. And then there's other days that, you know, it looks like we're going right, you know, like the whole Trump and the immigration and everything. It looks like we're going right back to authoritarianism again. So.
I think totalitarianism is dying. I think people have been given too much freedom with the internet for the governments of the world to try to control. Like John Kerry just said the other day, the internet is making it very hard to govern.
Yes.
But I think we're going to try to wrap it up, right, man.
Before we leave, back when the internet was first taken off a decade or two ago. I don't know who said it, but somebody said, if your business is dependent upon the ignorance of your customers, you are in big trouble. And I think that applies to the state as well. I mean, just like the Gutenberg press got the Bible into the hands of the masses, and they got to look at it and saying, hey, the church has been lying to us all this time, and you know, the church lost all kinds of power because of it. So we're seeing the same thing. You know, the transparency of the internet, if your business is based on the ignorance of your customers, you're in big trouble. And the state is based on the ignorance of their customers.
Correct.
But yep.
I do lean towards our side of the equation as far as how it all pans out in the long run, because I think we've got all the brains on our side. So I think long term.
When truth is on your side, it doesn't matter.
Okay, so I think we'll wrap it up, deliver our closing statements. And I just want to say that this conversation took a turn for the dark there with the World War III and nukes and the annihilation of human civilization. And that's definitely a possibility, but I cannot think that will happen. Because if I start talking like that with people who we're trying to educate about self-ownership, that's a complete turnoff.
I do not talk
to people like that.
Now you're cherry picking. You know, we talked about.
I know. No, you're right. You're right. You're right.
It could pan out.
No, you're right. You're right. And it's definitely a possibility. But I won't consider it. I will not consider it, because I think that the future is always up to the people.
Danilo was sticking his fingers in his ears and going, no, I don't hear anything about
that. You do know that Russia. You do know that nuclear war with Russia was like one key turn away, because. Right. They fucked up a message between, like, Moscow and a submarine, and he thought it meant pull the trigger, and he was like, wait a second. I can't in good conscience launch this nuke.
It was a Russian soldier or officer that went against the orders, right?
Yes.
And stopped it from happening.
Yeah, like, that man might be the most important man ever. Well, we don't know what would happen if. Well, yeah, we probably wouldn't be here without that man not pulling the trigger.
But Rand, thanks a lot for coming on the show. I really appreciate it.
Oh, it was great. It's a lot of fun.
Yeah, it's good to have you. So, one thing I was thinking about. I think Jeremy, you're talking about how, you know, we're waking up people slowly, and I mean, I actually don't like to use that term. Waking up is kind of condescending and patronizing. You know, I just say we're educating people,
getting people to think,
spreading ideas,
enlightening people,
spreading ideas. You know, that's kind of the way I look at myself, and I like it. Kind of reminded me of Harriet Tubman's quote, one of my favorites, which is I freed 1,000 slaves, and I could have freed 1,000 more if only they knew they were slaves, right? So it's a matter of perception, right? It's a matter of understanding reality and your, realizing the, I don't know if Dave would agree with this, but the universal laws of morality and economics and mathematics that
were. Now, why would you assume I don't agree with that?
No reason.
Give me. I need to understand this.
We're gonna go back to what was that, episode 2 or 3? And we got into the moral nihilism conversation.
I think we've had that more than once. we'll be here all night.
I don't think I'm a moral nihilist at all. I think I just can't prove that the human species matters to the universe. I don't think that's a nihilist. I'm not saying that it does or doesn't. I'm just saying I can't currently prove it.
Yes.
You know?
We know.
It's more like Nazi, right?
Yes. But
it's more. I don't know. I don't really know what the phrase to call it or anything. I just know that I'm not really a nihilist.
Okay. I just like the.
I may have nihilistic tendencies sometimes, but that's usually due to other people's ignorance being impressed upon me.
Yeah. Blame the other guy. Well, I was just gonna say the one thing I wonder what that Harriet Tubman quote actually I think. Proves my point, because yes, waking up, I know you hate that term. I'm not really a big fan of it either, but it's the truth, because
it's very apropos.
We're talking what you just said after you said that quote about, people recognize that, they have to come out of they're coming out of a slumber. That's what it's what it has to happen, right? Because, people just don't realize. But we could go on and on about that. But I too would like to thank you, Rand, for coming on. This was a lot of fun. I enjoyed listening to your interview with Danilo, so I was happy when he said you agreed to come on here too.
Was that book again?
Well, I'm gonna put that in the show notes. The Fourth Turning.
Fourth Turning.
Yeah.
Okay, and could you go ahead and plug all your stuff again, just for people that are listening?
Sure. My blog is randeastwood.com, and that's not just liberty, but it's everything that interests me. So I write on about 12 different topics.
Orgies. All right.
Yeah, orgies is one of the subtopics. Thanks, you just drove a lot of traffic to the website.
Score.
And then, of course, there's a corresponding Facebook page. It's Rand Eastwood Blog. And I'm always open to friend requests on Facebook. It's just Rand Eastwood. And my Liberty, I'm condensing all of my Liberty Facebook pages to one that's just called Operation Liberty.
I believe I've seen that one.
And there's links to all that on my blog and on my personal profile. I have links to everything, my Amazon author page and my Twitter and my YouTube channel. I do have a YouTube channel.
Did you find the merge pages function on Facebook?
Well, yes. They just wouldn't let me do it. The automated form, it rejected it because the names weren't similar enough. And then you can go a step further and make a request to them to merge the pages, and I went through that, and they came back again and said the names aren't similar enough. Nobody's looking at the content or the subject matter. They're just looking at the names and saying, it doesn't make sense. I had the Sovereigntarian and Evolve and Operation Liberty, and I was trying to put them all into Operation Liberty, because that's what I'm going to, if I do a podcast, that's what it's going to be called. And they just won't let me do it because they just think it's too different. In a way, I understand, because what they're doing is protecting the members. If 200 people have liked a page, you don't want to merge it into a totally irrelevant page and then they're, subscribed to it or something.
Of course.
I imagine it's something like that. But I would have thought somebody within the Facebook company could look at it and say, okay, all these are about liberty. It's just sort of the different facets of liberty, and they're all owned by this guy. But they said no, so I went through the deletion process, and the other ones are gonna go away. I think there's 5 days left in the waiting period, but Operation Liberty is gonna be everything now. So, and I may end up doing a podcast and a website.
Well, cool, I'm looking forward to that podcast.
Thank you. I've had a lot of people on Facebook encourage me. I've been putting trial balloons out. Maybe I ought to do it, and I'm getting nothing but positive.
I want 10,000 podcasts out there. It's more voices for people to hear. I don't care.
Hey, if the three of us can do it, anybody can. So.
Well, I do have like 4 people lined up that have already volunteered to be guests, And people are already subscribing to my YouTube channel, even though I haven't really been putting anything up. That interview yep. with Danilo was the first one. I just put it up this week. Mm-hmm. So people are waiting for it. It's just a matter of whether... I don't do things half-assed usually. So it's a matter of, do I want
to... It's hard to sit when you do things half-assed.
Do I want to commit to doing so? Because I've got a lot of irons in the fire. I got a book that's getting ready to come out, and you know, my blog has already taken up a lot of time. And plus, I work for a living. You know, I don't make money doing this. So I'm thinking real seriously about it, and I do have all the equipment to do it now. So I imagine I'm going to taper on.
Do it. Definitely.
Go for it. So.
I've got guys that are starting podcasts up for this network right now, and it's really cool to see people getting excited about just sharing what they want to get off their chest, and I think that's great for the movement.
And it's really cool for me being in the movement for 20 years and nobody listens, and now I'm seeing guys like you getting into it, understanding it, and accepting it, and spreading it, and everything, and it's really cool to see. Because I was really alone for a long time. You know, I met Harry Brown back in his 2000.
Cool.
In Houston, I met him personally.
Libertarian Party candidate?
Oh, yeah, the Libertarian Party candidate. I met him. And after that, when I went through a divorce and stuff, I kind of got out of it. But for a long time.
Yeah, divorces will fuck you right up.
You know, but we didn't have the internet back then. So it's like Harry Brown actually said in his speech that night, he talked about all the principles of liberty, the benefits of liberty, the prosperity that comes from all these things. He said, so anybody that understands those things would accept the ideology. They'd say, yeah, we want that. So we don't have a product problem. We have a marketing problem. He actually said that, and I agreed with him, and that was before the internet exploded. Well, now we have these marketing tools, right? And we can reach all these people. I mean, I reach, just through my little efforts here, I reach thousands of people a week. Mm-hmm. You know, all my various channels, and it's exponential. You guys reach way more than I do, but I just wanted to say it makes me feel good to see guys like yourselves jumping in and doing it.
What I've been telling everybody is it's not about numbers. I don't care if we have the best numbers or the worst numbers. I don't care, as long as one person hears this and goes, these guys are right. Holy crap. Holy crap!
Well, then we should be giving up already, because we already had that one person. our one fan.
Her name is Amanda.
No, we have a few. We have a good bit.
Job is done.
Done. Yeah, last podcast.
Hi, Amanda. How you doing?
Oh, she's gonna kill me. I keep talking about it. We talked about it. Lou and I talked about it last night on the Fiends.
Yeah, you did. But I really appreciate you coming on, Rand. You're a great guy. I enjoy your posts on Facebook a lot. I read them. I may not always comment or share them or anything, but I definitely do read them. And every time I see your stuff, I'm like, wow, this guy's he nailed it. So you keep doing what you're doing. When you're right, you're right. And when you're wrong, you got haters.
Yeah.
Haters are a good thing.
It didn't take me long to start ignoring those kind of, you know, when people just fly, when they just want to do mudslinging and name calling, and you know, and they're not gonna. I don't have any problem admitting if I'm wrong. If somebody says, hey, you're not considering this, or you know, whatever, and I'll always, hey, that's a good point, you know, I'll reconsider. But when people just get all emotional and they're not contributing anything constructive to the discussion, I just roll my eyes. You know, it's like,
I walk away.
Where'd this guy come from?
I walk away.
Yeah. I mean, I used to try to convince, I used to try to argue, prove I'm right, but I don't do that anymore. So
you're never going to tell someone, you're never going to talk someone into liberty. You can only give them the message of it, and then they have to figure this out. That's the difficult part about this. It's almost like a Buddhist monk. It's like, well, I can tell you what Buddhism is, but you can't be a Buddhist just by knowing what it is. So
Right. And there's a huge difference between trying to prove that you're right about something or seeking genuine truth. And since I seek genuine truth, my priority isn't try to make everybody believe that I'm right. My priority is this or is this not the truth? And then I go with that. So I don't let the naysayers' idiotic comments on Facebook, that they, you know, water off a duck. It's like Sam Harris says, there are some opinions that are not worthy of consideration. So that's the way I see it.
And if you're Austin Peterson, they're every opinion except for yours.
Yeah, I don't know much about him.
You're probably better off not.
Yeah, let's go down that road. Right.
I'm trying to goad him into coming in on the show so I can just, anyways.
All right.
Danilo, wrap us up, bud. Did he die? Danilo, did you get droned?
Yeah, he's Danilo frozen.
There he is.
All right, so why don't you wrap us up, Danilo? Awesome.
All right, well, Rand, thanks a lot for coming to the show. We really appreciate it. Good to see you again. Good to talk to you again.
Like I said, it's my pleasure. Thank you guys for having me on.
Yes, definitely. So this is so anybody wants to help out the Seeds of Liberty, you can donate Bitcoin or Patreon. The links are in the description. Also, you can help us spread the content. Like, commenting, and sharing the videos would help us immensely. Monetary donations help, but also just doing those simple free activities will also help as well. So thanks a lot, everyone, for listening. This is the Seeds of Liberty podcast. Wishing everyone have a wonderful day. Take care.
Peace. Bye.